This excerpt was taken from the Full & Bloom interview with producer-engineer Alex Perielis. You can listen to the entire interview at fullandbloom.com.
You get your start mastering Metallica's Kill 'Em All, correct?
No, I didn't master Kill 'Em All. I met one. Johnny Z, this is an interesting story, and there's people always ask this question. I've never really talked about it too much, but when Johnny Z was about to sign Metallica to Elektra, he released a four-song EP on Megaforce that was some songs from, you know, Kill 'Em All. And what I did is I remastered some tracks from the master tape of that, and then he wanted me to do another mix of something that so it would be a little different. And so that I did, I personally did a mix of Whiplash. And I never talked about it much because I don't think the band really wanted that to happen, and I didn't know that until much later, but I don't think that the band wanted something to be remixed or something to change without them being involved. And I had no knowledge of any of that, so I've always just sort of not talked about it because I didn't want to start a shit show, you know, from way back then. That's what happened, you know. So I didn't master that project. But, you know, at that point I was in my early 20s probably anyway, and I was working on projects for Johnny and for the folks over at Combat and Music for Nations and those projects that were going on at that time.
And so
that I was, you know, all of a sudden mastering something for the first time because I wanted to be a mastering engineer. It was just that I got to do the mix of that. And then the remastering I did actually, if I remember right now, I can't remember if we took it at the Tom Coyne or not, but I think that, you know, I had a long-standing relationship with Tom Coyne, who passed away, one of my closest friends in the industry, probably one of the most sought-after mastering engineers in the world. He was always a guy that I went to for encouragement and for help and for, you know, I was in the middle of mixing something. I sent him something really quick, and he'd help me, you know, make sure that I was on the right track with something. I think that he might have been the one who actually mastered that. I think I was the one who kind of put that thing together and made sure that I got the right takes and all that kind of stuff, and then I did do that one remix of Whiplash.
How does this whole association with Johnny Z come about?
Metallica did their first record in Rochester, New York, at a studio called Music America with a producer named Paul Curcio that came from the disco industry, is my understanding. I don't know a lot about his history. I think he just passed away recently. He wasn't that old. Maybe a little older than me, but not that old. And he somehow found his way to Rochester, New York, and opened a studio. They did their first record there. And Anthrax was the next band that was slated to go into that studio. And he was in the middle of changing gear. So Anthrax was supposed to be there. Supposedly, the story goes that they loaded up and went there, and there was no gear. So they were waiting around for a couple of days and then started looking for studios in upstate New York because they were up here. And Carl Kennedy, who is the drummer in The Rods, was friends with Paul Curcio's engineer. His name was Chris Bubosch. And somehow one thing led to another, and Charlie and Scott came to Pyramid. They said, we want to hear something that you've done that has guitars. And I played them something I'd been working on with a band from Binghamton, New York, that was pretty heavy, kind of a cross between Rush and Merciful Fate.
Wow. What was the name of that band?
They were called Lord West. And all those people, they didn't go forward with anything in the sense of careers in the industry. They were all talented guys, but they went multiple directions. In fact, there is a track on an album that came out on Megaforce that was called, I think, Deeper Into the Vault, which was a bunch of B-sides and stuff that was really odd and weird from the Megaforce collection. And the song by that band is on that album under the name Imperious Rex. So just to hear kind of what they were about.
So you play them, that recording, and and so that's how your connection with them begins?
Yeah, and then, you know, Carl was actually slated to produce the first Anthrax record. So that's kind of how that whole connection came from. And I had worked with Carl before. We knew each other from projects prior to that. So Carl was the one actually produced the first two Anthrax records that were done at Pyramid. You mentioned Spreading the Disease. He produced that record. I engineered it. Carl had a long history as a producer, and I did learn a bunch from him as well. And he was a very close friend and still is. You know, he lives in Pennsylvania now, but he lived in Cortland, New York, which is, you know, 35 minutes from us. We were friends and worked on a bunch of projects, and he's a very good producer and still active musician in a band called The Rods.
Armed and Dangerous, were all the songs on Spreading the Disease re-recorded, or were some of those just remixed?
No, Johnny was really smart, right? You gotta give John Z and Marsha Zazula, you gotta give them a thumbs up for being really innovators, because they were, you know, they created that label from nothing and turned it into a serious entity. It had a lot to do with the genre Records and all those early, you know, adopters of, you know, believing in the style, you know, without those people, then, you know, I don't think that the industry would have ever seen the bands that were, you know, that happened. And without those people that were believers, the major labels weren't going to look at that stuff and think it was worth anything. They are the special people that without their intestinal fortitude and their commitment to a style of music and the bands that they, you know, nurtured, we would never have the Metallicas and the Anthraxes and the Slayers and on and on and on. You know, I could sit here for 10 minutes and list every cool band that you know about that came out of that genre because of those people. John and Marsha's notion was to use it like a promotional CD or like drop it a single. But, you know, that was in the era when nobody dropped a single. The EP was the thing. So those four songs were dropped early to try to stimulate some interest in the band. So that's where we were in the midst of doing Spreading the Disease. But the notion was to finish those songs for the EP to stimulate some interest. And that's kind of what he did. And that was a really smart move.
You just remixed them, some of those songs?
Remixed them possibly, you know, or what was on the record was an alternate mix of a mix that was done for the EP. But it was like, get the EP done and then continue on making the record, basically. That's what happened.
Uh-huh. And so that's also
all from the same session. Like, the session went on. We stopped tracking, mixed those tunes, and then went forward.
You know? Oh, I got you.
It wasn't like a, you know, pack it up and go home and then come back. It was like that was done in the midst of the session.
That's the introduction to Joey Belladonna. Was there a favorite vocal chain for Joey?
Not necessarily favorite. I mean, you know, typically he always sang on either an 87 or a 67. You know, that was always the thing. Neumann's typically, you know, thinking about Mike preamplifiers. You know, we didn't have a whole lot of different pre's at Pyramid at that point. We had a couple of things. But mostly, you know, when we were doing stuff in the other studios, that's when we started looking at other options. But typically an 87, you know, an original 87, not an 87 AI, but an 87 for Joey, or a U67. Was always sort of a go-to for him.
And you use the mic pre's from the board, or you don't remember which one you used?
Let's see. For Joey at Pyramid, I would imagine, if I remember right, it was either going to be one of the older knees that we had maybe around at that time, or it would have been one of the pre's in the Harrison, which were really, really good mic pre's. David Harrison was a smart guy, had defected from MCI to start his own company. That's the lineage of Harrison.
Didn't Dan and Joey come in at the same time? I'm sorry, Dan left.
Dan left the band as well. So, you know, that's where you know, have a new bass player.
But that's the exact same time, correct? Frank comes in at the same time as Joey?
Yep.
What was the reason for parting with Dan?
You know, Dan was just going a different direction. You know?
Okay.
He was definitely, he was more into, you know, the more hardcore thing. And the band was definitely, you know, moving a slightly different direction. I wouldn't say it was whole hog different.
And then what about guitar tone? What's your typical go-to back then to record?
Back then, 57s and MD421s, basically. Always the same approach to this day. You know, sort of what I still go for at least that type of guitar tone. And it's really about, you know, guitar player, because I know I've read some other stuff that you've printed on your site about what other people say about, you know, guitarists and guitar tone and whatnot. And, you know, obviously there's some tricks to the trade, but the reality is, like, it's all about the person's hands and how they play. Because you could hand Scott's guitar to five people and it won't sound like Scott, or Eric Peterson or Alex Skolnick, same thing. You know, James Hatfield. I mean, I never got to work with James personally, but I just know from watching the videos and hearing him play and know how he plays that any of those guitarists, you know, it's about them. It's about how they play. It's how they mute. What gauge strings are playing. How do they personally react with the amplifier? You know, there's a symbiotic thing that happens with a guitarist between their hands, their instrument, and their gear. You know, and that's a very kind of zen personal thing. It's not about gear at that point. Because you can put a bad microphone up in front of somebody who's a good player and you're still going to get a great performance.